Five servant ministers, the Le Seigneur est avec vous. Vous êtes bénie entre toutes les femmes, et Jésus, le fruit de vos entrailles, est béni. Je vous salue, Marie, pleine de grâce, le Seigneur est avec vous. Vous êtes bénie entre toutes les femmes, et Jésus, le fruit de vos entrailles, est béni.
Jesus. Ancient of Days, as old as the world, as old as the world.
Oh, Praise the Lord.
Amen.
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 We thank the Lord for yet another opportunity in His presence. We thank you, Lord, for thus far you have led us. We ask, Lord, that you open our ears and our hearts to receive your word. I'm only flesh, Lord, but I trust in you. And you have never failed, Holy One. And so, Lord, glorify yourself in this hour, that you may receive glory. In the name of your Son, Jesus, I pray.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Our topic today says, though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. And our text is 2 Corinthians chapter 10, and we shall read from verses 1 to 6. And I will read in Jesus' name. Are we there? Praise God. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 1 to 6. I myself, Paul, appeal to you by the meekness and gentleness of Christ. I, whom I am humble, went face to face with you, but bold towards you when I am away. I ask that when I am present, I need not show boldness by daring to oppose those who think we are acting according to human standards. Indeed, we live as human beings, but we do not wage war according to human standards. For the weapons of our warfare are not merely human, but they have divine powers to destroy strongholds. We destroy arguments and every proud obstacle raised up against the knowledge of Christ, knowledge of God. And we take every thought captive to obey Christ. We are ready to punish every disobedience when your obedience is complete. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. You see, at the beginning of this chapter, you could sense something that is very obvious, that there is a division in the Corinthian church. And division is a very serious matter in the body of Christ. And we shall see, because Paul begins to address the Corinthian church from the passage that we just read. He spoke about his humility before them. He acknowledged that there seems to be some problems within the church. But his standpoint, the way he approaches it, he says, when I'm face to face with you, I am humble. But when I'm away from you, I am bold. You see, when I began to study this, my mind went back to a couple of things I've known about the Corinthian church. And this is my own take about it, is that it was a little bit problematic for Paul. It was a church that was diverse. The church comprises of the Jews and the Greeks. It comprises of those who are rich and those who are poor. There was all kinds of people. The church in Corinth was metropolitan in nature. And with that diversity came all manner of views, all manner of positions. You could see that Paul even began to address this early in the church of Corinth. Because in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, when you read from verses 4, from verses 10 to 17, 1 Corinthians chapter 1, you will see Paul addressing the Corinthians. What is it that I hear among you? What is this report that I'm getting among you? Some of you say you are for Paul. Some of you say you are for Apollos. Some of you say you are for Cephas. And some of you say you are for who? For Christ. So even at the beginning of the writings of Paul to the Corinthian church, he needed to address the issue of division. He needed to address this issue. Because the issue of division can make or mar a church. It can slow down the prayer group. It can hinder the progress of a prayer group. And it wasn't just in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 that Paul was addressing the issue of division in the body of the Corinthian church. Also, when you read 1 Corinthians chapter 6, you will see also that the Corinthian church was so dysfunctional that even when they had issues, they would take the differences among themselves to the court. And Paul was not pleased with this, because this is obviously hindering the body of Christ. In fact, in that 1 Corinthians chapter 6, you will hear Paul saying to them, why do you take matters that concerns you, concerns the body of Christ, and you take it to an outside court to address? And he said to the church in Corinth, do you not know that you will judge the world? Do you not know that you will even judge angels? What is this that I hear? And this is what is playing out in the passage that we read. Paul says in verses 2, says, I ask them when I am present that I do not need to show boldness, but daring to oppose those who think we act according to human standard. And so there is an opposition. He says, I dare to oppose those. And what is your position? He clearly says it. He says, those who think that we are acting in human standards. You see, what Paul is saying is not too far from you and I. Because the subject matter of division can delay the work of God in our midst. When a husband and wife are not united, there is a problem. When the wife and the husband and the children are not united, there is a problem. And for us, the divine adorers, they will say something to you and I today. Because this is a serious thing. And you will say, well, I'm already a member of this group. I don't think I'm divided. But can I tell you,
are not connected in body, mind. We are not united fully. There is a division. There was something that the Lord convicted me not too long ago. You know, by the special grace of God, the Lord led me back here, and I am grateful to it. I can't tell you what I have benefited by obeying divine instructions in my life. When he began this journey in my life, I told my sisters, I don't know if I'll be coming here every Saturday because I live very far. And she said to me, no, do what you can do. But when the issue of division began to arise, the Lord began to tell me, yes, you can. Because if I was to work on Saturday, I would still have made it. And so I told myself I needed to wake up. And can I tell you, if you are not united in what we do here, whether in coming to the prayer group, or the weekly programs that we do, or the instructions that the master gives us from time to time, you are creating a division even when you don't know it. So a few weeks ago, I had gotten so tired, and the enemy began to whisper to me, are you sure you're going to be able to meet up with all of these programs that we have in the prayer group? We'll have to meet on Monday, on Tuesday, on Wednesday, on Thursday, on Friday, and Saturday. So the only day that we have that is free is on Sunday, and some Sundays we have meetings that we have tomorrow. And so, you know, this is a serious matter so that we understand how division comes. Division can be mental. And one of those days, I got so tired. And I began thinking, what is the enemy that comes? He begins to whisper this into your subconscious. And gradually you begin to detach yourself mentally. You might be physically present on a Saturday, but the rest of the things you are detached mentally. And he began to whisper to me, you think you'll be able to do this? In fact, one person that is very close to me told me, you are not on the phone every day. You are praying, doing something. Is that how? Is that your new life? Amen. I said, well, that's the call. But what I'm trying to strike here is what division can do. Because when the enemy began to whisper to me, I began to entertain it. Yes, I began to entertain it. And so I said, you know what, maybe I shouldn't be, I should not join this thing. And there were times I would join, my heart is not there. It's on, and I'm so sorry to do it also. You put on the phone, and you're sorry to do something else. Amen. And the Lord convicted me through our system. You see, when we are united, when someone is beginning to pass, because the Lord knows the impact of this, he will send a signal. And there was a day, I think it was 2 weeks ago, it was a Bible study that we had. I was so tired, sleeping. I set my alarm. By 7 o'clock, the alarm it rang. I looked at it and said, this one is not happening to me. I went back and I was struggling. And in between, see how God is. He looks at the heart. While I was struggling, should I get up? And then at one point I put it on. The rosary was the opening prayer was going on. And I wasn't really connected. And then the Holy Ghost spoke to me. You know what he said to me? That word came with power. He said, I will give you rest. And as soon as he spoke this to me, the energy that got to me, I got up. He didn't say, I will give you sleep. Sleep was all I wanted. He said, I will give you rest. And then I got up. I was able to connect. You know, why am I saying this? It is important that we understand the importance of bonding together, being part of all that we do. There may be inconveniences with those. You can be subconsciously divided from a prayer group and you're physically available. And so this is what Paul is dealing with in 2 Corinthians chapter 10. That there are people who have contrary views. They do not believe in the apostolic ministry of Paul. They saw it as being fleshly, as being of human origin. And Paul says, those who think we act according to human standard. And in verse 3, this is what he says. Indeed, we live as human beings, but we do not wage war according to human standards. For the weapons of our warfare are not merely human, but they are divine power to destroy strongholds. So Paul identifies the problem of the congregation and the Corinthian church. They think that what we do, how often do we think contrary? We hear something about somebody in our prayer room and we run with that thought. We begin to entertain it. I am guilty of it. These people saw Paul, a minister to them. But they began to see the work that the Lord was doing in his life. They said, this man is acting, he's not. And yet they are part of the Corinthian church. And so Paul says, the way we approach this, he says, it's not by the flesh. When the Bible uses the term flesh, flesh, if you read the translation, some translations will say human standards. Some translations will say by the flesh. The flesh could mean two things. It could mean that you're acting as a human, which we are a human being. It could also mean that you're living a life of sin. Like Paul will say in Galatians chapter 5, he said, live by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the desires of the flesh are opposed to the desires of the Spirit. And he says the two of them what? Are opposed to each other. The desires of the flesh. Now what Paul is saying here is not necessarily sin. It's about a conception. It's about people looking at what is going on in the house of God. And they are saying this is of human origin. Amen? And Paul now says, how do we deal with this problem that we have in the church? He says, the way we deal with it is not by human standard also. They are thinking we operate as human standards, but the way we deal with it, with this misconception is to a point at which God has given us. And what did he say? He says, but we have divine power to destroy strongholds. And then Paul goes ahead to describe what the strongholds are. Number one, he says, we destroy what? Arguments. Number two, he says, we destroy arguments and every obstacle raised up against the knowledge of God. And he says, and we take every thought captive to obey Christ. Two things are key in what Paul just described here. One is he identified what the root cause is. Number one is what? Arguments. Number two is what? Thoughts. Argument. What's an argument? An argument is an opposing view. An opposition to a statement. That's what an argument is. You are arguing somebody, you know, it is, we know the status quo, but we don't believe in it. And you see, an argument is not the way you and I look at it. I'll give you an example. When the enemy came to Jesus, in the Gospel of Luke chapter 4, the Bible says Jesus was led by the Spirit and he went into the desert where he fasted for 40 days. When the devil came to him, he knew he was famished. He knew he was hungry. What did he say to him? He said, if you are the Son of God, do you by chance think that the devil doesn't know he is the Son of God? What he's doing is that he's arguing against the status quo. Because when you read the gospel, you will see that even demons, when Jesus will approach a person who is possessed by the demons, what will the demons say? They will say, we know who you are. You are Christ, the Son of the living God. But now the enemy is paraphrasing it. What does he say? If you are, that is an argument. Can I give you another example? In the Genesis chapter 3, this enemy came also with the same tactics. What we're trying to do here is to expose how the enemy can infiltrate our lives by argument. He came to Eve. What did he say? Did God say? That's an argument. Because in Genesis chapter 2, God already said. Do you think the devil did not know that God said it? He knew. That's an argument. Did God say you should not eat of the fruits of the tree in the garden? That's an argument. Can I give an example? So that we see what we're doing. Francis, how's he? Is he killing your wife?
Oh boy! No!
She is. You don't have one thing to answer. Is he?
Yes.
Oh, she is. Okay. Okay. Do you know why I asked the question?
You are making an argument.
You see, he just says something. He says, I'm raising an argument.
Because you already know.
Because I already know. Now the question is, why did I raise the argument? Anybody? You know, this is how the enemy manipulates us. And at given cause, something is proposed to us. Just like the enemy came to Eve. Did God say unto Jesus, are you the Son of God? If you are the Son of God. You see, the enemy is so clever that he knows if he comes directly to you and I, we will know he is. And so because he's smart, I would say, but foolishly smart, he goes the other way. He comes and he argues against the status quo. Do you know that I've been asking Brother Francis this question? Because I already know that Nkiru is a wife. But how about if I have something or two in me to say, oh, Brother Francis, you need the most skin on all these beautiful girls, and it's Nkiru that you're married. That could be my intention to get him thinking. To get him to begin to say, maybe I should not have him. Praise the Lord. Amen. That's how the enemy works. He comes in softly. Do you think you should have done this? And if you don't take time, you know, the problem of Eve in Genesis chapter 3 was that she had taken that argument. If you see, look at what Jesus did in Luke chapter 4, there were two different approaches. Because what we see in Genesis chapter 3 is typically what is playing out in Luke chapter 4. The enemy comes to Eve. Did God say you should not eat of this? First of all, he lied. Because the instruction was not to eat of the fruit of the tree in the middle of the garden. And you know the mistake of Eve is that she entertained that conversation. She answered him directly. Even in spiritual warfare, you are not encouraged to engage the devil. What happens when I was reflecting on this, one of the things that the Lord opened my heart to my mind, he says, what is going here is what is called the battle of the mind and the senses. That's what Paul is talking about. He says, we destroy this argument. When this argument comes, how do you approach it? Do you approach it like Eve? You see, Eve began to entertain it. Jesus, in contrast, did not even say it to the devil. He said, it is written. Thou shalt not live by bread alone. He did not even want to entertain and ask the devil, did you just ask me if I'm the Son of God? That is what Paul means by we destroy arguments. You bet upon arrival. As soon as that argument comes, whether it is coming from the devil or from someone that you know, don't be afraid to engage. There are many people who have lost their mantle. Because you keep in into what someone will say. You see, when the mind is corrupted, the senses follow. As soon as Eve entertained that, you see the conversation even got longer. When now Eve now said to Satan, well, God did not say we should, he said only the tree in the middle of the garden. And then he finally responded again, second time. No, you shall not die. For the day you shall eat of it, you do what? And that was the point that God gave. Because the Bible will say in the next verse, and she looked at the fruit of the tree. And she saw it was what? Good. It was what? Desirable for gaining wisdom. The question that I ask you is, do you mean that Eve has not seen this fruit before? She has been seeing it. But what has happened is that an argument was raised. She did not deal with it very well. And because the mind has been corrupted, the senses followed. When you lose the battle of the mind, you lose that of the senses. Except by the grace of God. That's what Paul is saying. That the matters of division in the Corinthian church is stemming from arguments, is stemming from pollution, things that the enemy is implanting in prayer group. You know, sometimes you can hear something and you run with it. It can be dangerous. Paul says we destroy the argument. We don't let it have its fruit. And when Paul now talks about, he said after he analyzed how we can deal with the thoughts, with the arguments, he now went to the subject of thoughts. Thoughts are also another way the enemy has access into our lives. You see, thoughts in themselves are not bad. There are good and bad thoughts. And as sister has always said here, thoughts are as equivalent as words. When you think something, God already knows what you're thinking. He really knows. In the Gospel of Matthew chapter 9, there was a story of a paralytic that was brought in. And the Bible says that when this man was hauled down, Jesus saw him and said, "Your sins are forgiven." And the Pharisees, the Bible says, they questioned this in their heart. Now, what did Jesus say to them? He said, "What is this evil that you think?" They were not saying it. But Jesus knew the thoughts of their hearts. And he questioned them, "What is this thought? Why are you conceiving these things?" My brothers and sisters, we battle with thoughts constantly. Whether it's coming from us or it's coming from the enemy, it's a reality. It was what ended the ministry of Judas. In the Gospel of John, chapter 13, verses 2, the Bible says, the enemy had put it in his heart to betray Jesus. So the first thing that happens is that the mind is corrupted. And once the mind is corrupted, the senses follow. And when that happens, there's a tendency that the child of God will fall into sin. Paul said, we destroy arguments. And we do what? We hold captive thoughts, our thoughts captive. This was the problem. Because if you read 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, I was just read, Paul knew what was the problem. He said, this matter, we don't deal with it. I come to you. When I come to you, I come to you in meekness. Because there are some battles that you don't come. It's not something we do with, my people will say, kaka. It is something that Paul says, we have divine powers to do what? To deal with the struggles. One of the divine powers you have as a child of God is your humility. Your humility disgraces the devil. He hates it because that was his major problem. Thoughts, arguments. We battle with these things constantly. There are marriages that have been wrecked because somebody went to somebody to want advice. There are ministries that have been almost destroyed because the enemy infiltrated. You know, there was a video of an ex-satanist on this subject matter because until we're able to destroy arguments and able to put thoughts captives, we're still creating room for the enemy to divide us. We're still creating room for the enemy to divide us. And if a prayer group is not united, so that when you hear something outside, say, no! Death upon arrival. That's not the truth. Because that's how it comes. Why should you be here this Saturday? Don't you know what it means to do? You mean this is your life? And then somebody's going to give you a call. "Hey, sister, I haven't spoken to you for a long time. Would you mind? We're trying to get some people together to go and hang out in the evening on a Saturday like this." You say, maybe I should. An argument is being raised. The heart is being tampered with. Paul says, what do you do? We destroy the argument upon arrival. Jesus says, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. We need to be united. We need to destroy and take thoughts captive. When I was struggling with that thought that came, just the fact that I was entertaining it, I was really moving away from the prayer. Subconsciously. Because I'm telling myself, I cannot do this. And I'm looking at it from a physical standpoint. And next time I was about to tell the story, I'm sure some of you watched the video. What struck me was how they were able, he described how they were able to infiltrate a group of 20 women who were praying, and the impact of their prayer with their pastor was causing major progress in the kingdom of God, that over 7,000 people were being converted because these 20 women decided with their pastor for 90 days that they were going to pray. And that they're going to pray and fast
6 hours every day. So when the signal was picked up on the other side, because in the realm of the prophetic, nothing is hidden. The devil knows you. And this young man was given the assignment. He's an ex-separatist. They say your assignment is to go and not to confront them. Just like Paul says, we don't confront them. We don't come to them with human standard. He says, your job, they sent him and said, your job, don't go and fight them. They will kill you because their prayer is very effective. They say, but try and get him and divide them. That was the assignment. And the young man, when he was still in that kingdom, he said, give him money. 20 women had the power. The light of their commitment was spreading across Uganda and other places. Men of God across the universe. That is why we are the body of Christ. We are connected. You know, your sin affects me, my sin affects you. Do you know that? The mass is the same, but the grace level is different. The holiness of the priest, the holiness of the people that come in Christ. You don't say it's me, my body. People say my body. Which body? We are all connected. And so this young man said, they gave him the assignment. First of all, he said they gave him a book, 5,000 pages, where he is, the devil had written down the story of the Trinity women. He said he had to study it. And he said, each of them, they studied and knew their weaknesses from their family line. And what happened? He said, after they had studied, they said, okay, we know this person. And he now had to travel, he recruited the people, they came down. And the assignment was to go and try to join the prayer group, the women. By this time, the women had completed, they had only 21 days left from their 90-day commitment prayer. And they came in, they came with money. They began to, find their way. And because they knew the weaknesses of the pastor, of one of the women who was prophetic, they say that one had an anger issue. They didn't know that she had an anger issue. He knows your weakness. He knows your weakness. And that is what he exploits to get you an anger. And so they came in. They also knew that the pastor needed money. And so they came with money. They infiltrated. And when they asked to join, one of the women said to the pastor, we said this is only for us 20 women. We already in a covenant. Why do we want to bring in someone else? Somehow something happened. The woman became angry. As soon as she became angry, the demons came in. Because anger created the other. And they began to have problems. They came in, one of them made a big donation. The pastor said, hey, money he has not seen. This is the first time he sees this type of money. He said, God has answered the prayer. Let them come in. They came in, infiltrated the prayer group. You know what happened? They had 1 more day to complete that prayer, but because of disagreement, they did not complete that prayer. The enemy thrives on division. Divide and conquer. Divide the family. Divide the church. Father against mother. Mother against father. White against black. All you hear in the news is this person against that person. We destroy the argument. Let's not allow division to come into our midst. Brothers and sisters. Let's destroy the arguments upon arrival. And what do we do? How do we overcome this? Jesus gives us the way out. Like I said, once the mind is corrupted, the senses can follow. The same way Eve looked and saw that the fruit of the tree was good and desirable for gaining wisdom, that second temptation, Jesus did not fail it. Because if you read the account of Luke chapter 4, you see that the enemy, after he failed the first one, he came for the second one. What did he do to Jesus? He took him to the high place and he showed him the glories of the Lord. And said, if only you can bow down and worship me, I will give you all of this. He lied because the Bible says in Psalm 24, the earth and its fullness is of the Lord. Who gave him the glory? The devil plays on our thoughts and senses. Eve looked. You see, for some of us who are married, and
for the young people. If what you watch matters. I confess, there was a time, I don't know if you know this program, they call it the Batman. I don't know if you guys have anything. Somebody got me into it. I had to run. Because I knew if I did that in this scene, I would put myself in trouble. It's a regular show. What you watch matters. Because that is the enemy capturing us. You know what, for the young people here, when you watch a horror movie, what is the tendency at night? What happens? There's a chance you have nightmares. Right?
Yeah.
What you consume, what you listen to, they form your subconsciousness. That's why it's not recommended. You as a Christian, there are things you need to run. Paul says that argument destroyed upon arrival. They taught keep it captive. So that we avoid division. Because before there is a physical fight in the church, before there is a physical division, the battle of the mind is already lost. That of the senses is also lost. So how do we get around this? Paul himself gives us two things. Number one, in Romans chapter 12, he says, do not conform yourself, from verses 2, to the standard of this world, but allow God to do what? To renew your mind. Romans chapter 12, verses 2. Allow God to renew your mind. To change you from eternal, from inside out. That's what has to happen. If your mind is still corrupt, the enemy will come to you. You see, once an opening has been made, just like the exit and he said, they knew that the prayer warrior had an anger issue that had not been dealt with. And what did they do? They went and exploited it. To enter. Romans chapter 12. The scripture says, allow God to renew your mind. That's the first thing that has to happen. The mindset. Change your mind. Change your thinking. There was a priest who was here. He used to say to us, change your filthy thinking. Father Bill, amen. Change your what? Your filthy thinking. Because that's what the enemy is. We need to hold our thoughts captive. And the best way to do this is to allow the Lord to renew your mind. It has to be a change. That old mind, say, Lord, change this mindset. And the second thing that Paul gives us is what we have in Philippians chapter 2. We shall read it. I know we don't we're going for it time that I run up. We read Philippians chapter 2. Verses 5 is where I'm going. But we can read if you're there. Philippians chapter 2. You can read from verses. Let's start with verse 1. Yes. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. My point is in verses 2. It says, make my joy complete. Be of the same mind, having the same love, being full of one accord and of one mind. Paul says this to you and I today. Be of one mind. He says, make my joy complete. Be of the same mind, having the same love, being of full accord and of one mind. And there's something very strong that he says in verses 5. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus. You see, if we are to deal with this subject, we need to allow the mindset of Christ to envelop us. That mind that is in Christ Jesus. In Romans chapter 2, Paul talks about allowing God to change our mind. But in Philippians chapter 2, he now says about the mindset of Christ. Let that mind that is in Christ be in you. If that mind that is in Christ be in you, there will be no room for argument of the enemy. Because you now have the mindset of Christ. But one thing is the mindset of Jesus. The mindset of Jesus is that of obedience. Because the next verse he says, who though he was God, did not count it as what? As anything to grasp with. But he emptied himself, taking the form of man, being obedient. Obedience even unto death. We need to die to ourselves. We need to die. We need to die to ourselves. Let that mind that is in Christ be in you. You need to ask the Lord, change my mind, O God. Change me. Change my thinking. Change my mind, O God. Remove the filthiness that roams in my mind. Remove the thoughts that are not of you. Remove that which is not of you. He says, let God renew your mind. Let him renew. That's what we need to do. So that we can destroy argument. We need to wear the mindset of Jesus. We need to put on that mindset that was in him. Paul says, make my joy complete. Be of one mind. Be of one heart. Husband and wife, be of one mind. Be of one heart. Be of one mind. Children with your parents, be on the same page. We need as a prayer group to be of one mind. The Corinthian church was divided. And so like Paul, we're going to ask the Lord, change my mind. Change my mind. Oh. Give me that mind that is in Christ Jesus. That I may be one with your people here. Lord, I give you my heart. Change me, Lord. Change me, Lord. Change me. Lord, renew me, Lord, by your grace. Ah, Jesus. Do a surgery in my heart, Lord. Change my heart. Change my mind, Lord.
Every step that I take,
yes,
every moment I'm away, Lord, have your way with me. Lord, I give you my heart,
Jesus.
On my phone to get into prayer Thursday. Praise God. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Even the daughters of this, Jamal is walking there. Amen. Because at the end of the day, Jesus is the doctor of all doctors. Amen. Okay. Any other person? Okay. Let me give a testimony. I haven't given this testimony yet, but I think during the week it began to come to me. Amen. So last year, me and my family went on a vacation. We were in Canada. And one of those days, my wife left. You know, this is the first of us men. We have to respect women, whether you want to or not. Respect them. So she wasn't home. She went somewhere. And my kids said, we want to go swimming. We want to go swimming. I said, okay, let us pack. We came down, they all dressed up. I went to the reception at the hotel and I said, do you have the kids? I got to the swimming pool. My kids, they started going in. I did not pay attention to the depth of it. And within seconds, my third daughter was already inside. Underneath, the other two were really scrambling for breath. I don't know how to swim. But can I tell you, these things happen in seconds. They were already on the other side of it because the pool starts from where it is small. I didn't know it was that deep. And what I didn't know whether to go in or not. The next night, I don't know how to swim. I jumped into the water. And thank God, the person who doesn't know how to swim. I was able to bring all of them out. Even after the lot, we came out. We are all. I was. Is it how people? Is it how this thing will end it? Is it how it will end it? In a two-car. I can't remember sharing this, but this is what. This is the work of God. This is the work of prayer. Praise the Lord.
that you may unveil your glory, O God. As you unveil your glory before Moses, and allow him to see your glory, we ask that your glory once again be unveiled in this place, O God, that this may become the place of glory. This may become the place of glory. Brothers and sisters, we want to pray for this child, Chikozie. Stretch forth your hands towards him. We're not praying as individuals, we're praying as a prayer to be united. And our prayer works. Begin to lift up this child before the Lord. Begin to pray and the Lord will intervene. The Lord to intervene in his life, that the hand of God may come upon him. Open your mouth and begin to pray. Father, the hour has come. Once again, we present your son before you. We present him before you. We demand, oh God, we demand his release. We demand his release. We demand his release in the name of Jesus. By the power of the Spirit of the Most High God, who is great and mighty. Deliverance, let there be breaking of yokes, let there be removal of limitation, that which has hold you. Let it be broken, let the chain upon his life, let it be broken, let the chain upon his life, let it be broken. Father, in the name of Jesus, by the power and the Spirit of the Most High God, arise, O God, arise in his family, arise, O God, let there be reversal, let there be reversal. Let him be uprooted out of his life. Deliver him. victory of Jesus on the cross of Calvary. By his dying on the cross. But he paid the price. He said it is finished. Let it be so, for Jesus. It is finished in the name of Jesus. Glorify your son. I receive you. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Let your glory come. Oh God, we give you The God of life will send you forth from their lives. The Lord will be in their life, bring to fulfillment. Thank you for the wonders of your name, for the wonders of your creation. We decree, Lord, that they are blessed in the morning. They are blessed in the afternoon. They are blessed in the night. Abraham's blessings are theirs. Even the spiritual blessings and the heavenly blessings we speak over them. It shall be well with them. This year there will be no tragedy. This year there will be promotion in their lives. They shall experience new heights. Spiritually, in the name of Jesus, breakthrough upon their lives. The desires of their hearts shall be met in accordance with your riches in glory. Have a blessed name. Because for the giver of life and every good deeds, you are the great provider. Continue to keep them for yourself, O Lord. How great is your name? In Jesus' name.
To arise, to rise,
prayed. And a clap of hands to Jesus.
The rosary, praise, worship, confession, beseech, honor, please, love, adore, and testify to his goodness and just be in his presence. And allow him to touch us with his love that heals, restores, edifies, inspires, encourages, develops, and delights in our presence as we honor his. Come and literally cry out to the Lord Jesus and acknowledge him for who he is, what he has done for us, and ask pardon for all the ways we have offended him and his mother. Confessions are available, and as he convicts you, go wash your soul in the sacrament he instituted for you to give you a way to put yourself in his good graces, which are sanctifying, and which open the door to heaven to you. So, where are you on Saturdays? There is nothing more important now than to get right with the Lord. Time is short, and destinies are being decided, and souls are being lost. He thirsts for souls, yours, and all souls he has invested with life here on this earth, this testing ground. Finals are coming up for this generation, and there are no do-overs when the test is over. There has to be more to life than what we see out here, and there is. Come and get a taste on Saturdays, a little taste of heaven.
Fridays, the liturgy from Friday is 3 p.m. begins with stations at 1:30 as a challenge, and Novena at 2:30, and then Easter Vigil at 8:30 p.m. Wherever you are, don't miss those liturgies. It's kind of flat when a Catholic is fired up during the week, but then misses the High Holy Week. Those three liturgies, every Catholic should be at. They're not obligatory in the sense of moral obligation, but hell, it's when it's happening. So to miss that is really to miss a big thing. Thursday, Institution of the Eucharist. And then we go until midnight. We have adoration and confessions. I would hope that one year divine adoration would take over the adoration and do it all night long. That would be my desire to see that happen. Maybe not this year, but some year in the future, I would love to see that happen. And then, of course, Good Friday is all good because Jesus gave his life for us on Good Friday. So when we count the Passion, veneration of the cross, receive Holy Communion, and then Easter Vigil, when the sacraments are received. And we have the procession of the candle, the fire on the front lawn, which is where we begin. We begin on the front lawn on Easter Vigil. We also begin on the front lawn here tomorrow because we have a procession with the palms around the block. So if you're coming here, dress warm, wear good shoes, because it's going to be a little chilly tomorrow, my son, but be nice. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. You are the reason we are here, and we rejoice in your presence among us. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Unto Mary, sacramentus, venere,
Blessed be God. Blessed be His holy name. Blessed be Jesus Christ, true God and true man. Blessed be the name of Jesus. Blessed be His most sacred heart. Blessed be His most precious blood. Blessed be Jesus, the most holy sacrament of the altar. Blessed be the Holy Spirit, the Paraclete. Blessed be the great Mother of God, Mary, most holy. Blessed be her holy and immaculate conception. Blessed be her glorious assumption. Blessed be the name of Mary, Virgin and Mother. Blessed be Saint Joseph, her most chaste spouse. Blessed be God in His angels and in His saints. May the heart of Jesus, in the most blessed sacrament, be praised, adored, and loved with grateful affection at every moment in all the tabernacles of the world, even until the end of time. Amen.
Holy God, we pray.
To talk to you. Do you think it's possible that we can do it next week? Yeah, because next week he has to do something tomorrow at the school. So I wanted like all of us to be there to do it. Yeah. Okay.
How's your brother?
He's good. How's everything going with, like, Michael?